Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this night that you've given us, God. Thank you for allowing us to just get together on a busy night, to put aside our schoolwork or anything that we had to get done to be here today. I pray that you would bless the speakers who are speaking tonight on the panel about church. And that whatever comes out of their mouth is from you, God, and not their own. May everything that is said be glorifying to you, God. I pray as we lead tonight that we would just be in prayer for the talents God has given us, God, and the things that God has allowed us to have. And I pray that we would be able to use that for His glory in the church and in our relationships with others. Lord, I pray for those who are still looking for churches as well, that they would be able that you would lead them to a church that you want them to be in, God, and where they could utilize their gifts to its full potential, God. So yeah, bless this night in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You're calling me to come and behold the wondrous cross, to explore the depths of grace that came to me at such a cost, where your boundless love conquered my boundless sin, and mercy's arms were open wide. Heart is filled with a thousand songs, proclaiming the glories of Calvary. With every breath, Lord, how I long to sing of Jesus who died for me. Lord, take me deeper into the glories of Calvary. Triumph of your wounds by our Savior's crimson flow, holy wrath has been removed, and your saints below join with your saints above, rejoicing in the risen Lamb. My heart is filled with a thousand songs, proclaiming the glories of Calvary. With every breath, Lord, how I long to sing of Jesus who died for me. My heart is filled with a thousand songs, proclaiming the glories of Calvary. With every breath, Lord, how I long to sing of Jesus who died for me. Lord, take me deep into the glories, Lord, take me deeper into the glories, Lord, take me deeper into the glories of Calvary. Thank you.
Ever I So much that we can just rely on you for our strength, Lord, and that your strength is what we ultimately point to at the end of the day when it comes to just serving you. And God, I just thank you and praise you so much for all the kids who came and joined us today. I'm so encouraged by them, and Lord, just make us vessels of your truth, and just messengers of how simple and joyful it is to just serve in your kingdom work here, and just a source of make us, Lord, a source of empowerment for these kids who came to join us, and everyone who is tuned into a large group today, to serve in your kingdom and continue the good works you have planned for us here on earth. God, we just love you so much, and we dedicate this time to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
All right. Thank you, Talissa and Zoe, for leading worship. Let me make a breakout room real quick for the kids, and then we can get started. Okay. Let's see. As the kids are going in their breakout room, I'll go ahead and share my screen and we can get started. Okay, one moment. Sharing my screen just puts everything everywhere. Okay. Alrighty. Again, hello, welcome to Large Group. Today we'll be doing another virtual panel, kind of like what we did in fall quarter. I really know, winter? Fall or winter? I don't remember exactly, but yeah. And so this panel will be focused on serving and participating in the church, since our sub theme for this quarter is this is how we know how to be involved in the church. And since we have a lot of our members in AA serving and participating in their respective churches, we thought as Large Group team that it'd be cool to kind of hear from their perspective, what they do in their churches, how they came to serve in that regard, and just to be able to share the fruits of their labor for serving God at their churches and participating in their church. So yeah, to further explain, we always like to say AACF is not a replacement for church, which is true. And so hopefully we'll use this time to encourage one another to participate and serve in the church, aside from just going to Sunday services. I know that we're able to do a lot more. And so I hope that what we hear today will encourage all of us to want that for ourselves too. So, yes. Before I introduce our panelists, I'll pray us in. So let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you again that you're listening. I thank you for this time where we get to talk to each other about your glory, the work that you do for your kingdom, and how you've called us to do so much and to be able to be a part of a community of believers and to be filled with so much joy, being able to be part of a community that is serving you. May we use this time to listen to what you have to say through your children, Lord. May you give them the confidence to be open about their answers, and may your glory just shine through what we talk about tonight. This night is yours, and this night is about you and your church, and I pray that you would guide us through it and through this night. I lift up all of this, and I pray this in your son's name, amen. Okay, so a different thing we're going to try and do is instead of us sending a Google form beforehand, you guys can send in your questions live. So throughout the panel, if you have any questions that you would want the panelists to answer, if you have any follow-up questions, you can send it here. If someone, or Peter Martin, if you could put the link and the code in the chat so that people can have it. I think I'll be able to see them. Yeah, I think I should be able to see the questions that pop up throughout the panel. So if you have any follow-up questions or anything, I will do my best to bring those up. Let me type it. So you go to that link, canva.live, and then you enter that code, and you should be able to put in any questions that you may have. So with that, I'll go ahead and introduce our panelists. All right, so first up, we have Peter Vaughn. He is a student at Cal Poly SLO, just like a lot of us. And he's currently in SLO. He is a part of AACF, as well as the Cal Poly Food and Science Club. And how he got involved in his church, he was in the parking / security usher at his church before college. Is that right, Peter?
Is it better if I explain it?
Yeah, go ahead.
So basically, before college, I was at my home church, and I helped out with parking, cooking, these little bit of security and ushering. A lot of those were just things that I helped either with my that was either inspired by my family, what I like to do, and just wanting to help people. So, and obviously, when, in college, I'm serving at my current church, Calvary Slow, doing the multimedia. And I just got into that because they said they needed help, and I thought I could try it out and see what happens.
So good. Okay. Do you have any fun facts or hobbies or stories you'd like to share?
I don't know. I like to edit, so. But you could see next week I'll be posting Charlie's day in the life video. You just saw Sophia's just got posted. She did a good job, but I edited Charlie's. I hope you guys enjoy it. It'll be very memey.
Plug. Okay, thank you, Peter. Next, we have Zoe. She is also a student who is currently in SLO as well. She's a part of this fellowship as well as Vineyard Church in Glendora. She's also part of the Cal Poly Food and Science Club and Cal Poly Symphony, a lot of stuff. She is serving in the worship team slash sound and youth ministry, or that's how she got involved in the church, was serving in the worship team, sound and youth ministry. And she really loves Earl Grey, which is the best tea flavor. Okay. All right. And then next we have Rachel. She is currently doing ministry work as well as playing. She's currently in AG in Arroyo Grande. And she's a part of Journey and GMA, and she involved herself in the church through the children's ministry. And do you have a fun fact or a holiday story? It's okay if you don't have one. So yeah, welcome. And then last but not least, we have Ada. He is a process engineer at a pet door company. He's also in SLO. Oh, we're all in SLO. Cool. And then he is a part of Vista Church, and he served in the Tear Down group at Vista, and he's also part of a small group at Vista. And a fun fact is he's a really good Mario Kart player, which is debatable,
That's
but
not what my fun fact is on the sheet, but that's okay.
it's subjective. Also, I think Rachel, you have a fun fact that you'd like to share.
Did Phoebe text you that?
Possibly.
Okay, it's not really a fun fact, but it's a trick. So I don't know how many of you guys like struggle figuring out like what grade someone is in or like what age they are. So like if someone's like, oh, I'm like 8, and you're like, what grade is that? So basically, you take their age and you subtract 5, and then that's the grade that they're in. But it only works if they like went to school like not early or late. And then it usually works better in like the beginning of the year. So Phoebe is like 20, and so you subtract 5, and that's 15th grade, which is third year in college.
Interesting. That is a fun fact indeed. Thank you for sharing. All righty. So we have our panelists. So we'll go ahead and jump into the questions that we kind of prepared in advance. And so the panelists know of these questions, but I'll also try to be aware of any of the questions that show up on the live Canva session, and the code should be somewhere in the chat. You guys can look for it. But yeah, so before we talk more about what you guys, because you guys all do very different things in the church and participate in the church in very different ways. But I think before we talk about that, we should probably backtrack a little bit and just learn more about how you guys even involved or how you guys found your church and what it was like joining a church first, because I'm sure we'd have to join a church before we start serving in it right away. And so I think one thing we could kind of talk more about is just some qualities that you guys might have looked for in a church when you were looking for one. And so this question would be for Zoe and Adam, if you guys can share of any qualities that you thought about in looking for a church?
So, hi, I'm Zoe again. And some qualities I look for in a church. I grew up in my church that I'm currently serving in. But the qualities that my parents looked for in a church are the ones that I also carried into like my kind of like church experience, church looking for experience. A big thing for me is intergenerational ministry, so which means basically every age group in the church is involved in like every aspect of the ministry, whether it be like compassion ministry, outreach, worship. It's not like segregated into this kind of Mickey Mouse shape where it's like the youth, the kids, and then the adults, like here. It's all one kind of homogenous kind of circle where like kids can be involved in worship and they're involved in setting up, tearing down, serving food, and the youth are teaching the kids are teaching the adults too, and of course the adults are mentoring the younger kids. And yeah, that's something I look for in a church, and I am grateful to be planted in a church where they enable kids and adults of all generations to participate. Yeah, because there's no such thing as a junior Holy Spirit, right? It's like, it's all just the Holy Spirit. It can touch and lead any person of any age to a spiritual gifting, and they can participate in any way. So that is the main thing I look for in a church.
Yeah, that's true that there's no age to qualify you to be able to see the Spirit and serve. Yeah, what was the word again that you just that you used to describe it?
Oh, with the like everyone being involved?
Yeah, something generational.
Intergenerational. Every age, every generation is ministering and teaching each other, and it's not compartmentalized. So
never heard of that word before, but that makes a lot of sense. All right, Adam, do you have any qualities that you look for in a church?
I don't know if it's like qualities, but like, unlike Zoe, I didn't start going to church until I came to college, and so I don't have like a home church, I guess. And so at least what I've kind of learned is, you know, every church should have a mission statement or like a something on their website usually, or just kind of like outlining the values of the church. And I think I've kind of learned how to, you know, read that and kind of discern for myself whether or not like this is a church that I'd want to check out, especially earlier on in my walk when I was at home. Like during breaks, I was trying to find churches, and reading the mission statement, I think, helped a lot, just to kind of gauge like where the church was at and like what they valued. Some churches are like very like outreach heavy. They're really focused on like, you know, homeless outreach, or others, or they have different programs and whatnot. And so at least for me, like, kind of looking and researching about the church and reading like what they value and what they kind of stand for, I guess, you know, besides just the obvious values of like biblical truth and like love for others and love for God, like seeing where that church is and like what they believe their mission is kind of what I've used to find like a church that I think would work for me. But at least when I was looking and trying to figure out what church I wanted to call home, that was what I was doing a lot. It's like reading their mission statements and trying to figure out if I could like fit in there and grow in that environment.
I guess this kind of is an easy transition into the next question, because I know that you go to this the church, and so I'm sure that you are aware of their mission statement. And so since we already know which church you go to, could you kind of explain more of the process of finding Vista and finding a church in SLO for you?
I first went to Calvary my freshman year, more because that was where the people that were taking me to church would go. So I kind of just tagged along. And this was especially when I had no idea really what I was doing when it came to my walk. And so it was nice to have that kind of, I guess, encouragement and accountability to have people bring me to church. But I wouldn't say I was like a part of Calvary. I kind of just went, and I kind of got tired maybe of Calvary. And so I decided to like look around. Calvary is a great church. I just don't think at that time I really understood like why I was going, or I felt like I was going for the wrong reasons. And so I wanted to kind of find a church that would work for me in my own walk. I tried out Shoreline for my second year, and then didn't really work out, I guess. I think Shoreline is also a great church, but the community is a lot older, and so I found it kind of hard to relate to the people in that community. So I just kind of didn't see myself being there long term. And then over the summer, I think before my third year, is when I found out about Vista. And it was pretty sick, because like it's like 5 minutes from my house, so that meant that I didn't have to wake up super early for church on Sundays. But I just remember the first service I ever went to, I saw the pastor just walking from group to group and introducing himself and like trying to get to know people. And like he ended up meeting me that day, and he ended up like asking me if I wanted to like grab lunch to like get to know me, which was kind of wild. But it left a pretty good impression, and I felt like, I don't know, it felt like an environment, just like with the people and the people in the community that was there, I felt like it was something that I could grow like with and be a part of. And I started to get more plugged in with like small groups and serving. And I think that helped a lot with me finding my home in that church, because it was a lot, I think it was a lot different than me just going every Sunday and not really having any ownership or like feeling like I'm really a part of this community. I'm just kind of going on Sundays, but to actually involve myself and like be a part of the community that's like actively serving and stuff, helped a lot for me to actually want to continue to go to Vista. And I think there was like a lot of people and that I met that I feel like God's like worked through in my life. And yeah, I just feel like at least now it's been like a blessing. But it's also been great to like challenge me and like force me out of my comfort zone. So I think it just took a lot of self-reflecting and figuring out like what I wanted out of a church and where I saw God like using me in a church. I think that was what I had to like figure out for myself, and you know, had to keep trying to find a church that actually like helped me grow. And it wasn't just something that, I guess, I think we prayed about it, but it's not just something that we go to check off on our list on a Sunday morning, but to actually go and actively seek God. So yeah,
I'm glad that you were able to find that at Vista. And I know they have in-person services now, right?
They do, in Calvary's parking lot, LOL.
Sharing the space. I know that, Peter, you go to Calvary and you also serve in Calvary. And so it's interesting to see how for Adam, you know, it didn't necessarily work out for him to be able to continue going to Calvary. But for you, you're able to go to Calvary. And so what was the process for you for finding a church, specifically Calvary in SLO?
I would say that I was looking for a church that had very focused biblical teaching that really went in depth. I feel at least for my home church, it never really felt that way. It was always very, in a sense, surface level. They always focused on an overarching theme or message, and found verses that brought things together. But what I found that I enjoyed with Calvary, at least for me, is that finding like the little things that you may not have known, and really putting into context the verses, and it really comes in a series. So every week you're able to come back and able to connect on what he said the week before. And I find that to be more interesting because it helps me to keep things retained more often. And yeah, just the community has been very good. Although it's definitely weirder now that I'm pretty much the only person that goes, it's still good because everyone there, it's crazy to think that they remember your name, like the leaders remember your name somehow, even though you don't come like very often. And I think that's something I see with the people that take care of the college students. They care for them and want them to support them the best way possible. So that's why I really enjoy going to Calvary, at least.
Yeah, thanks for sharing. Also, there was a question for you, Peter, earlier that I missed that was on the live chat thing, because you did put that you served as a parking / security usher. And so someone asked if you arrested anyone while working security.
Okay, to give context to this whole situation, the ministry that my home church basically called it was Brothers and Sisters in Christ Serving. And so that spells BASIC. BASIC? Yeah, BASIC. So BASICs, the BASICs ministry. So we do all types of things. It includes parking. Parking is basically security because you're just basically checking, making sure everyone's parked and can get a spot, and obviously looking out to see if anything sketchy is going on. So yeah, nothing heinous ever went down, but it was just it was great. You didn't have to stand in one place for very long. It was very active, and I loved being able to help anywhere and everywhere. And that's what the ministry was really about.
Ministry. Yeah, I'm glad that you did not have to arrest anybody. Okay, so yeah, thank you for sharing on how you guys found a church and joined it. And so we'll kind of transition now into participating in the church, because I know that going to church shouldn't just be going every Sunday. We want to be able to participate more in it. And so I think to be able to do that, we kind of need to recognize where we would want to participate and how we're able to participate. And a way to do that is to kind of identify your spiritual gifts as well as the skills that you have that you enjoy doing and be able to use it in the church. And so this question will be for Zoe. How do you use your spiritual gifts and skills to serve in the church?
So how do you use your spiritual gifts in the church? I think first to understand how you come to know and use your spiritual gifts in the church, you have to understand the source of where it's from. So the source of where the gift is from. So in the Bible it says every good and perfect gift comes from the Lord, and it's by his strength alone and his love that we're able to pour out our service to him, and what he wants to do in the community around us. So I feel like for me, in discovering my spiritual gifting, it was very much a community kind of thing where we were encouraged to foster talents that we were showing at a young age. So back in the Philippines, my parents were heavily involved in the worship ministry, and so were my uncles and the rest of the church. So they brought me to a lot of their jam sessions, and they would just like drink iced tea and on a hot day and play worship music, and they would let the kids sit in too and would play songs that kids would relate to, and as well as, you know, really deep and meaningful worship songs. So kind of being organically brought into a culture of service also is how I discovered that I loved to serve in worship ministry. One day my dad just gave me a djembe and said, like, hey, you want to try this out? And then I started like patting on it, and that was the beginning of where I am now. In terms of spiritual gifting, all the spiritual gifts are like connected. So like worship ministry is like connected in some way to compassion ministry, is connected to outreach, and so like it's kind of the job of the church to empower and encourage others to use their gift. Just to foster kind of a participatory environment. I don't know if I digress, but yeah.
Yeah, someone asked, what is compassion ministry?
Oh, so compassion ministry is closely related to outreach, but basically, if your community has any needs, any needs that are brought up in the church, or there's someone, it's basically like someone needs help, or there is a crisis going on, like either globally or something going on socially in our world. It's these people are called to, who feel spiritually called to help in those crises and provide either, you know, like monetary help, or even like fight for justice essentially, and compassion for these groups who are kind of in a bad situation or mistreated.
Wow, all these ministries are very unique and very cool. All these new terms that I'm learning, very cool. Thank you for sharing. And then I guess our last question in regards to participating in the church before we move on to serving in the church would be if you guys have any words of encouragement or advice for those who are still looking for a church or are unsure of how to serve in one, because I know that can be difficult, especially during this time. If you're looking for a church, it's a little bit more challenging because, you know, not everything is in person. So this question is for Adam, Peter, and Zoe, if you guys have any words of encouragement or advice that you'd like to share for other people who have not found that church yet or know how to serve specifically.
Right now, it's hard. I think if you don't have a church, especially now, because it's not like you can, I don't know if everybody's comfortable with just going to the in-person services that some churches might offer. I still think that churches are still trying to provide ways for members and new members to like be engaged and to meet people. I think there's, at least I know Vista does like smaller scale like events for college students, and I know that we have our small groups. So I think there are, if you're really interested in looking for a church, like there's probably some things that the church is trying to provide, at least in this time, to kind of help with that. I think too, if you're like nervous or unsure, like I don't know, you're all friends, I would hope. Like going with other people, I think helps a lot. I think the only reason, one of the biggest reasons, I wouldn't say the only, but one of the biggest reasons why I think I like stayed with Vista and I really liked it is like I went with my housemates and we all kind of got plugged in at the same time. And so it didn't really feel like it was just me kind of extending myself and like doing different things, but I was doing it with other people, so I think it made it a little bit easier for me. So I don't know, like trying to check out new things with like a housemate or a roommate or just somebody that you trust, I think helps a lot. I mean, serving doesn't have to be like, you know, something really big. It can be like I did tear down, which was just literally folding chairs every other Sunday. But it's like you can probably do small things, so it's at least to you as an individual, it doesn't feel like a gigantic burden, I guess, on like a Sunday or any other day of the week. But it can just be something smaller, that would still benefit the church, but you can still serve in that capacity. So, yeah.
True, there is no task too small or too big to do to serve in the church. Peter or Zoe, do you guys have any pieces of advice?
I would say for the kids in this call, just like what Adam said, there's no task too like big or too small. One of my oldest friends, Danny, she comes in every Sunday and cuts the bagels for church, and that's like what she loves doing. And she's been doing that for years, and like that's her ministry. She calls it bagel ministry. And the kids at my church, they do this thing called basket ministry, where they refill the pens and notepads together. Like they all gather together in the morning and refill that. So kids, I encourage you to even just like find new ways to serve in the church, the ways that maybe your church hasn't even seen before, and also reach out to those grown-ups around you, and yeah, just follow what they do, see what they do on a Sunday morning, and then join them, and then yeah, just do that. And for us college students, do the same thing, you know. God like calls us to like be like children and come before him, and that's how we ought to serve him. So just do that. Don't be afraid to reach out and be explorative like children in the ways you can serve in the church.
I love bagel ministry. It's like a competition to brownie ministry. All these ministries. But yeah, Peter, do you have anything?
I would say just be open to anything the church asks for help for you. I echo what Adam said. It can start small, just helping take things down when you see that people are putting things away and such, and not being afraid of stepping outside your comfort zone. If it may not always be with your friends that you come to church with when you serve, but it's just a rewarding experience, just knowing that you're doing some, you're taking part in serving and helping other people's days to be better when they come and experience church, the same way you did before.
Yeah, wow, these are all good pieces of advice. Thank you guys for sharing. All right, so we'll kind of move on to talking more about serving in the church and participating in the church, since you guys are all doing that at the moment. So this question is for everybody, but yeah, would you guys be able to describe what you do in like a given day or a given time? When you serve slash participate in the church, so like how you would prepare worship or do children's or AV, like could you give us a day in the life?
Okay, a day in the life. So I'll do like a day in the or like a week because it's like a week long thing. So typically we have our children ministry meetings on Thursday. And that's usually an hour. And depending on what we're doing, someone's like preparing the lesson, and then we'll talk about the lesson, and we'll talk about like the game and worship and like the schedule for Sunday. And then we'll pray for the kids. And then on Friday nights, we actually have house church with the kids. So the kids actually would normally have house church, but they're here instead. And for house church, the prep that goes into it, normally we'll either like prep something like reading the Bible and like discussing it, or we'll just watch VeggieTales sometime and learn from that, or we'll just not do anything and just watch videos and let them like hang out. And then on Sundays, we have our children ministry Zoom. So during the Zoom, we just like have the schedule that we were going to do. And then the kids will like participate and listen to the lesson. And then we'll do prayer requests. And then usually the kids will pray. And that's usually how it goes.
Sounds so fun. So it's like a weekly process.
Yeah, it's every week. Yeah.
So cool. Alrighty. Would anybody like to go next and sharing what they do?
I can go, I guess. So usually I have to get to church about at least an hour, hour and a half, at least an hour, hour and a half earlier than normal. This was before the pandemic, obviously, but basically I would come in, turn on the equipment such as projector, make sure the TV is on for the pastor to see his notes, and then I would make sure all the slides are in order, and make sure music's going to work, and just switch the slides whenever the worship people need it changed, because while we probably all know the songs, it's very important for at least when you stream it for it to people to see it. So I just need to be very careful in not switching the slide when it like I sometimes it skips to the chorus when, and that's bad, but that's about it what I do.
Slides are very important. Zoe or Adam?
I can go. I guess before the pandemic teardown, at least that's like the main thing I used to serve on Sundays. I mean, Vista is unique in that they don't have their own building, so they have to come in the morning and set up. And then after services are over, they have to tear everything down and put in a trailer and then bring that trailer back to the Vista office. So it would just mean I'd have to stay like an hour or two after the second service to help take down everything and clean up after everybody. I don't know, at least when I was doing it with my housemates, it was kind of fun because we'd like take the dollies and kind of like one of us would push each other and we'd like grab the stuff off the ground and we'd go really quick. And we kind of made it a game, so it was more enjoyable than just like stacking chairs or picking up pens and Bibles. But yeah, it was just essentially tearing down the in like the church setting at the Vets Hall and packing it up every other Sunday. I did also serve like briefly on like their reset team, which is basically after the first service, in between that and the second service, they need some people to kind of reset the venue, pick up all the trash and clean up. So it's like tear down, but a lot easier. But I stuck with mainly tear down. And so that's really what it entailed and what I did. And then we'd usually go get food after we like did that with the people that we served with. So that was pretty cool.
Zoe?
So I serve on mainly on the worship ministry at my church, and my dad's the worship pastor, so I just kind of join along with him on what he does, but he's allowed me to kind of shadow him over the years, and so Basically, what I do is sort of at the beginning of the week, I think of songs that are relatable for what the church right now is going through or facing, and then I ask the pastor like what the gist of his message is, so we can find songs that are applicable to that. And sorry, and then Thursday I email the songs usually, and then on a Sunday morning, so I get to church 3 hours before service starts, and like Adam's church, Vista, my home church also does not have a facility of their own, so we have to set up and tear down everything, including all of the sound equipment, drum set, everything, like yeah, chairs and cafe area. So we start really early in the morning. So we get there and set up all the equipment and have our practice, and yeah, and then just make sure to catch up with all the people on the team that we're serving with, and also making sure to pray with each other. And then, yeah, after that, towards the end of service, or at the end of service, we tear down everything and bring all the instruments back to our church office too. And that's what I do on a Sunday, and yeah.
Nice. This next question is kind of a follow-up to your answer, actually, Zoe. But and you kind of answered already, like how your dad is the worship pastor, and how your church doesn't have their own facility. But how did you decide that you wanted to serve in a certain area at your church?
It's a family thing, so like I said, in the Philippines, like my whole family back in the Philippines are also they also serve in the worship ministry, and yeah, I feel like it was just something that was like passed down. There's this tribe in the Bible called the Levites who love their service in the church is to kind of keep the like orders of the tent of where they were worshiping, and also to be worship leaders, like play instruments. And so my family and I like to kind of look up to them and what they did, and you know, their service didn't stop at just playing instruments. It was like all of the packing up, all of the wire coiling, and all of that. And even though that stuff is tedious, like it gives me some sort of like unexplainable joy to do it every Sunday. How did I know that this is the area I wanted to serve in? I just knew, I guess. I don't really know how to answer it too much because, yeah, I kind of grew up in it, but and kind of discovered the giftings early, I guess. If you're like inclined to tech, inclined to organization, even inclined to serving in food, if even when you're really young, like we should nurture that in kids, and so they know and feel compelled to serve in starting in small ways and even greater ways in the future.
Yeah, I love how you mentioned that it gives you unexplainable joy. I feel like that kind of unexplainable joy is something only Jesus can give, especially through work. Being able to find joy in our work and what we do is really fulfilling and really nice that Jesus gives us that. So yeah, kind of going back to Rachel and how you're talking about serving in children's ministry, I know that since you say that you plan this on a weekly basis, I know that it may sound intimidating. It might be a lot. So, like, did you have any apprehensions before serving, and what allowed you to overcome them, or if you're still learning to overcome them?
Yeah, I think, well, this will tie into the next question, but I think some of like the apprehensions or fears I had were like a lot of them were because I was like looking at myself. Like I just felt like what can I give to like these kids? Like I'm not gonna be good enough. Like I remember the first couple of times I would give a lesson, like I just wanted to cry afterwards because I was like, it was so bad. And I remember everyone, like the teachers would come up and be like, oh, like that was so good. And I was like, no, like that was horrible. Like I don't even know what I said. So I think a lot of it was a lot of the fears that I had were because I was just like looking at myself and I just felt like inadequate to be serving these kids because kids are like sponges, like they just soak everything up. And it's like really scary to think about that. Like you tell them one wrong thing and like you could probably like change their life. So I was like, this is kind of scary. So I think it's like something that I still like struggle with, and it's still, I don't think it's something that you just like overcome, but it's like something that you just have to surrender like daily, and especially with it being like a weekly thing, like I have to think about it a lot. So I think like through prayer and like talking about it with their team and like just encouraging each other and that, I think those are like ways to like, it's just like reminders to rely on God always. So I don't know if I like overcame them, but we're in the process of continually surrendering them.
Oh, that is so true. It is a daily surrender to God. All of our fears and struggles, it's not just one moment, or it could be, but yeah, surrendering it to God daily is what we need to be doing. Someone put in the live chat, this is a pop quiz question, Rachel, but someone put in the live chat, what were some of the greatest joys and some of the greatest challenges that you kind of answered the second part, but if you've had any, if there are any greatest joys that you've had while serving at your church.
Yeah. So I think specifically in children's ministry, so our children's ministry start when the kids are 4, I think, like when they're in pre-K, and then we go up to 6th grade. So I think with one of our kids, or like a lot of our kids, like you see them start out like really shy and like they yeah, like they're just like, I don't know what to say, like I don't know how to pray, like what do I tell God? And then you just see it like over the years, like how confident they grow in God and like in their prayers. And now like during Sunday school we'll have like time for like prayer requests and like we'll be like, oh, who wants to pray for what? And all the kids are so excited to pray and like their prayers are so good. Like I think there was this one time and we have like a chart with the 4 different types of prayers. And I remember I was like teaching a younger class. So I was like, oh, like it rained this weekend. So I'll just like thank God for the rain. And then I remember this kid, like, oh, well, I won't say her name, but I remember praying for like the homeless population and like this like whole thing. I was like, dang, like I literally, I mean, like, thank God for the rain. But I was just trying to think so simple-minded like a kid and like simplify it. But I think like one of the greatest joys is just seeing your kids, or not your kids, but like our children's ministry kids blossom and the confidence that God has given them and really grow into like these kids and like teenagers and like hopefully adults, like how God has created them to be and like step into that. Yeah. And then what else? I think our children's ministry does a really good job of like showing the congregation like what the kids are doing and what the kids are learning. So because of COVID we did a lot of video stuff. So I think just seeing the kids like put all that effort in and then seeing their faces when they see the final product of like all the hard work that they put in. Yeah. And then like when a kid is saved, that's when you're like, wow, like God is so good. And a lot of people are like, these kids are too young, like they don't know what they're talking about. But like you see the change of like their prayers and just like the way that they want to like serve even at a young age and like the way that they're just so like nice to each other. I don't know. Yeah.
So good. That reminded me of one verse that I quickly Google search right now, but it reminded me of Matthew 18, verse 3, where Jesus says, "Assuredly, I say to you, unless you change and become as little children, you will by no means enter the kingdom of heaven." So it really is having that childlike faith, which obviously kids can have because they are children. But yeah, it's very true. And we all have to have that childlike faith to be able to enter the kingdom of heaven. So yeah, you kind of answered that next question that we had on the doc. So we'll move on to more of talking about personal reflection. And this question is for both Rachel and Adam, but how has being part of a church helped you in your personal walk with God? Because I know serving, participating, you're constantly giving and giving, but how are you able to fill yourselves with God through being a part of the church?
Okay, I'll go. I think being a part of church, I think it's helpful to have, like, just surrounding yourself with fellow believers. Like, church as a community for me, I think is great, especially because, I know you guys are all in AA, and I know it's great. I mean, I was right there with you guys last year, but now that I'm not a student, I think without Vista, it would have been a lot harder, I think, to adjust to, like, post-grad life. But having that community of people to, like, pour into me, and to, like, kind of push me and hold me accountable, I think has been, like, really helpful in my own walk. And I just think, in general, having, like, community outside of AA, as amazing as it is really helpful, because you get exposed to, like, different views and, you know, different just people in general. And I think that that's been really helpful for me. Just learning kind of the different ways that people choose to pursue God, and, like, learning from them, and hopefully, like, you know, they can learn things from me the way I pursue God. But ultimately, all of it helps to, like, push us all closer to Him. But yeah, I just think, like, being involved with the church, I mean, it's like, I don't know, like, for the rest of our lives, it's always going to be there to kind of help us and guide us. And so it's really helpful, I think. And it has been for me in my own walk to help, like, push me in the direction that God wants me to go. Yeah, at least provide that accountability that I think I always, like, know I need. It's just, you know, it's just always, like, I feel like given to me through the church, because, like, you know, you can go to, like, Sunday, like, Sunday after service, like Vista does, like, prayer during the last worship song, you can go up. And I've had times where I've been, like, honestly, like, too afraid to go up, and then, like, my small group leader will come over and just pray over me. And I don't know how he knew or, like, why he, like, felt called to do it, but, you know, just, it's very, like, reassuring and encouraging to, like, have a community like that outside of AA. So
that's true. AA is not a replacement for church. I say it so many times, but so true. Rachel?
I think for me, I think there's, like, two ways. So I think, like, serving in a church, I think that, like, ministry will help you keep you accountable for your relationship with God. Like, as much as I'm, like, pouring out into a ministry, like, there's people pouring into me. And then I think the second way is, I think, like, Monica read that verse. I think, like, watching kids pray and, like, how they pray and how they're just so, like, not weighed down by the world and, like, what we've been through. I feel like when we pray, it's, like, so different. So I think just listening to how kids pray and just, like, the faith that they have, they're, like, in their eyes, they're, like, oh, God can do, like, God can do anything, but, like, to them, it's so, like, real. Yeah. And then I think just being, like, a part of a church and, like, having that community and, like, serving in that community to get to better, like, know your church, is definitely like a really good thing. Cause I think for me personally, I think if I didn't have this like community of believers that I could turn to, if I'm like, if I have questions or if I'm struggling or like whatever it is, I think it would have been like really hard. So definitely just like walking alongside with like brothers and sisters in Christ. Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. We're running this race together. It's not just you constantly pouring, but also being able to receive guidance and help too is very important. So yeah, thanks for sharing. I don't see any other questions in the live chat. Oh, just kidding, something came right now. let's see. This one's for Peter. Someone said, tell us about some of the most memorable experiences you've had while going to your church. It could be a funny story or some way that God spoke to you.
This is referring to, you think this is referring to church in college or church?
I guess either. Could be while going on Calvary, if you have any memorable experiences, since that's the church that you're currently going to. You didn't arrest anybody at Calvary, right?
I can't really think of any that are specifically from Calvary. I got one. I think I was serving at Calvary for... No, I was... So basically, I was riding to church. I was on my roommate's bicycle, and basically, as I was riding, I hit a pothole, and it caused the tire to leak and pop and leak. So I had to walk to the rest of the church, and I told the coordinator that, hey, I'm going to be late. My tire popped. So I had to... unfortunately, I was pretty much stuck. I was trying to figure out how to get home, but thankfully, another one of my roommates was able to pick me up, and we took the bike back home. And it was just a very, it was just a blessing to have a wonderful roommate who can help in when I'm in a dire situation and can get me home, because we all know that out there in Bucharest, there's not much public transportation out there. You get cheap food, but not cheap transportation is kind of whack, but yeah.
I can confirm that. Yeah, thank you for sharing that interesting memory. All right, so again, I don't see any newer questions. I think we went through all the questions that we've already prepared beforehand. So I think we can spend a little bit of time in breakout rooms to talk about some small group questions to kind of reflect on what we've talked about and be able to relate it to your guys' lives for everyone else listening. So here are the small group questions. I'll make the groups smaller so that's easier for you guys to share, and we'll probably be in these groups for about 10-ish minutes because I know it's a little bit late. So if you guys can take a picture of this in case you forget the questions, I could probably broadcast it too, but if you can memorize it right now. I'll give you like 10 seconds as I'm preparing the breakout rooms. Okay. So yeah, I'll probably bring us back in about 10 minutes. You guys can just use this time to reflect on what we've talked about and kind of see how we can encourage each other to be able to also serve and be a part of a church if we're not already in one. So yeah. Thank you.
Again, for such a wonderful night, we got to hear our panelists speak, and thank you, Lord, for just instilling wisdom into them and them sharing it to us, God. Lord, I pray that we could leave today and not forget about what was said tonight, and that we could truly live it out, live out your will for us, God, that we could get plugged into church. And yeah, even though it's really hard right now with our current situation, God, I pray that, yeah, that you would just allow us just to be able to either tune in online or if in-person services are available, God, that we would be able to just get out there and see how we could be used both online and in person, God. Lord, I pray that you'd bless the rest of this night, and may our conversations and our time of fellowship be glorifying to you. And in Jesus' name I pray, amen.